That's a month since Midge has been in, and we're now at this sort of final magic process of fitting the neck to the body. You know, and once this is done, you know, we can go ahead and install the preamp, you know, and then start setting the guitar up for final playing. We'll still to work out whether Midge is wanting a scratch plate on it or not, because it's going to be for stage use, and usually that involves, you know, quite hard strumming. Every guitar we make, we put our symbols on it, which are a crescent moon and the letters moon, and that ensures us that it's, you've got a moon guitar, what, no matter what shape the headstock is. This gave us particular challenges because the Midge wanted all the inlays in black. So the only way that we could get it to work with the matte finish was to have the inlay raised above the surface. So it took a bit of thought on how we were going to achieve it, but we managed it, and we've got a great result here. We're really happy. Also, the dots on the fingerboard are also in black as well. Again, more challenges, but we came up with the right ideas, and we're quite happy now. This is a faulty, it's just one that didn't work out. It was destined for Roy Harper, but the sides actually warped during the, you know, the bending process. So we tried to save it, but we couldn't, and it's a shame because it was a lovely piece of wood. This is that, what we call the side shell. It's two pieces of wood that we've bent into the shape. We've got a neck block and a heel block and linings. The top of the guitar is basically, you know, it's basically flat. It's not, but it's basically for demonstration purposes, you'd say it's flat. The back has a curve, you know, and it's different shaped all the way around to take the shape of the back, which we put braces on it to give it a curve, and you know, and then, you know, we'll shape that in by hand. Then we'll cut the notches for the braces to sit in, and then basically we'll just glue it. Guitars are constantly trying to destroy themselves by the physical act of the bridge, you know, pulling forward, you know, from you know, with the tension of the strings. So our job is to create a top that will vibrate in many different frequencies, but be strong enough to take this torque that happens to them.
You're nervous? I'm nervous.
Listen, I'm not. I know you've done a fantastic job. Oh wow, look at that. Oh, that's a thing of beauty. That is wonderful. And you're right, it's as black as you can possibly be. It's wonderful. But I'm just looking at this. I'm loving the inlays. The black inlays and the matte black.
You've got your black saddle.
And a black saddle as well. Look at that. That's wonderful. Look. We wanted an album sleeve with Ultravox that was black, matte black, with gloss patterns on top. And you've managed to pull this off, because I can see the outline around the sound hole and the detail and the name.
You still get the name. Yeah,
yeah. The name is embossed. I can actually feel it sitting.
Yeah.
It's risen above the
flushness of
the
head. Yeah, that was the only way we could get
head.
That to show.
How'd you get on with the neck, the width of it?
Yeah, I was quite happy with it. Yeah, it felt, you know.
See, look, that is so that is so clever how you've done this, because you've managed to have the matte black finish on the wood on the surface of the guitar, but you've also got a matte black binding around the edge here. It's a slightly
it's
different
funny.
Shape.
It's black. It's black binding, but it looks.
It looks more grey than yeah. black against the thing. You can see it there. That is such a beautiful
finish.
That's
the same binding that's on the, you know, the mandolins.
Oh yes, I see it. Yeah,
and
yeah.
It looks really black on the white wood.
It rings, doesn't it? It's beautiful. It's got a lovely depth to it, and a lovely jangle. was beautiful. It really is beautiful. And the neck feels great. You know what? For a brand new guitar, there's a bit of deja vu going on here. It feels as though I've had this guitar before.
Oh.
And that's really weird. The body size is perfect. Mm-hmm. It just sits really well balanced, sitting just perfectly there. I could sit and play this thing for hours. If I was a better man, would fellow men take me to their hearts? If I was a stronger man, carrying the weight of popular demand, well, me, would that appease you? I want to please you again. That's beautiful. That's fantastic. The BBC World Service, the series that delves into the minds of creative people and finds out how they work and think. I'm Midge. It's great being back in Scotland and in my hometown of Glasgow. I left here 40 years ago after my pop group Slick split, and I headed south to London to play with new wave band The Rich Kids, and then Neuromantics, Visage and Ultravox. More and more I'm returning to my songs with an acoustic guitar, and I need a new one to play live with. I've got a homecoming gig in a couple of months, so I need the guitar ready so I can pick it up then. I'm heading over to the south side of Glasgow to see guitar maker Jimmy Moon. Jimmy's the go-to guitar maker here, and he's made guitars and mandolins for the likes of Coldplay, Simple Minds, Bryan Adams and Steve Earle. So I'm sure Jimmy's the man who can help me reimagine some of those synthesizer tracks on an acoustic guitar. Just come off the main road out there, down this little alleyway, and I've come into a courtyard which looks like an old stable block. And part of this stable block is a great big sign saying Moon Guitars. So I'm going to go in and meet Jimmy now.
Hello, how are you?
Jimmy.
Yes.
How you doing?
Nice to meet you. Brilliant.
This is fantastic. I've just been saying, standing out there, you know, this is like a stable block or something.
This is old stable blocks where they used to have the tram cars, you know, when they were horse-drawn. This is where they kept the horses. Seed loft upstairs where we work. And the carriages were kept over there.
That's fantastic. How long have you been here?
About 40 years.
Wow. Hang on to this. Don't let this go. This is fabulous.
So, Midge, what do you look for in a guitar?
Well, yeah, for me, it's I'm not really an acoustic guitar playing. I mean, recently I've been doing a lot of one-man shows and acoustic things and transferring what I've done in the past to acoustic guitar. I think something smaller that's easily accessible, that just sits comfortably on my lap when I'm sitting down. So yeah, possibly the smaller ones, but I might have to try some of your guitars. You've got a fantastic display of the different range that you do right here, and I have to say they're all very appealing.
Well, I think we should maybe start off, maybe sit down with one or two of the guitars and try them and see how you feel.
Absolutely. Pick something.
I'll pick one.
Have a bash.
This is probably our flagship model. It's the one we make the most of. It's a full-bodied, small. It's got Indian rosewood back and sides, Alaskan spruce for the top, and mahogany neck, ebony fingerboard.
It's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. Oh, it's got a lovely ring to it, which is... See, most of the stuff that I end up doing isn't the kind of twiddly diddly stuff. I end up just, it's accompanying me in the song. So I'm strumming it, and I tend to hammer these things. It's not delicate what I do with an acoustic guitar. It's quite brutal in its own little way. So I'm kind of used to battering these things. So it has to still have a quality of tone, but a lovely jangly resonance that when I hit it hard, it's really going to go. That's great. Yeah, I love that. And it's a lovely shape as well. It just sits very, very nicely. Because I think my other guitars are quite a bit bigger than this, and this is great. Small guitar for a small guy.
Yeah, but they produce, you know, a small guitar, they produce a lot of volume.
Yeah, this is great. It's really nice, yeah. Wonderful. Let's try something else.
Yeah. And that's basically the same guitar, but it's cut away in one side, so you've got access to the top of the fingerboard.
Top of the fingerboard.
So this one has a pickup fitted.
Oh, that's very sneaky. That's well hidden, that.
Yeah. And that's just a little volume and tone.
That's wonderful. So that's...
It's the kind of thing that sound guys hate.
Oh, really?
You know, a guitarist with a volume control.
Volume, and that's a tone. Right, okay, got it. Perfect.
How does that neck feel?
It's slightly wide for me. I don't know if you can do them.
Yeah, we can.
Sit on that. It can be a
little bit. Because they're all handmade, it doesn't stop.
You are a luthier. You're an instrument maker.
Yeah.
How did you start doing that?
I started it when I was 15 with one of my buddies. We saw a TV program by a guy who's making Appalachian dulcimers as a stick. And we looked at it and we thought, we can do that, but we can do it better. So we got the stick and we split it open and made it into a triangular shape, and we both made these dulcimers. And he went on and did double glazing. He's making a lot of money. You know, I stuck to the guitar making, and you know, here I am trying to sell you a guitar.
Yeah. Besides the dulcimers, when you got into making guitars, what did you put into these guitars that you couldn't find in other people's guitars?
Well, when I first started out, I did an apprenticeship as an engineer, so I had some idea of layout and measurements, and I took that. Looking at friends' guitars and looking inside them, you know, I started to understand, you know, the bracing structure and what it was all about. So at first I was working blind. I had no books, I had nothing. I was just kind of working away and, you know, keeping my family in poverty just to try and, you know, achieve my goal.
But it's not just about mathematics, though, is it?
You know, no,
there's heart in this.
It's balance.
This is passion.
Yeah, it's balance, you know, and it's finding the balance between absorb the strength of the strings and not distort, but be light enough to create, you know, all the frequencies that you want to hear. You know, also suppressing other frequencies that you're not wanting, you know, and that's what it's all about.
I don't know whether you're trying to hide all these gold and platinum discs you've got on the wall with your guitars, but you've obviously made guitars for some serious people here. Who have you done them for?
Well, I suppose Big Country were one of the first big names we ever got. You know, Stuart ordered the guitar, so Bruce was in right away. He wanted the guitar, and we kept that going. We made them mandolins and 12-string guitars. You know, sadly Stuart passed away, but you know, we still think fondly. Get Brian Adams, Adele, Steve Earle, Scissor Sisters, guys out of Texas.
Wow.
You know, it's Dougie McLean.
And now little old me.
Well, yeah, you're never too late to get a moon guitar.
Thank you very much. This is obviously the kind of front end of the business here, because you've got guitars, not just yours, but other things that that kind of come and go, you buy and sell. Can you show me where you do the serious work?
Yeah, without a doubt. It's great, sir.
Thank you.
It's messy.
I would
should
hope
have warned you to wear old clothes in here.
Any working environment should be messy. My studio is a mess all the time. Ah, so now look, we've just walked into your workshop, and immediately the smell hits you, the wood, the glue. It's fantastic. I absolutely love this. Glorious.
Well, thank you. That's sometimes it's my hell, but at moments it's my heaven. I mean, this is really what we've got. It's just basic. In the downstairs part, we've got basic, you know, woodworking machinery. You know, we've got sanding machines, you know, saws, you know, dust extractors. We've got a little machine for bending the sides, this is the downstairs part. We've got another part upstairs.
Okay.
We'll take you up there and you can meet my apprentice.
Wonderful.
Just watch the stairs, they're quite narrow. Attention, Stephen. This is Midge, this is Stephen,
hey.
My apprentice.
Pretend you're working, we're coming to check you out. How are you doing?
Yeah,
oh, this is great.
This is Stephen Devine. He's been with me about 30 years. He's my number one, you know. He does all the specialised trim and all the finishing, all these aspects of the guitar. He's fantastic.
That's beautiful. What a great job to have, though. I love it. So, Stephen, when you get people like me coming along here with stupid ideas, you must have had more stupid ideas than the ones I've got. What kind of finishes have you had to do in the past?
We did a tartan guitar once. We did a camouflage guitar. It was a big electric, huge body.
Could the guy find it?
eventually.
Not if he was playing in the woods.
No. But it did. It looked fantastic.
The idea for my guitar is everything you've just shown me. And every colour you've got and every wood you can do. Is there something black? Because I love the idea of an ebony fingerboard, but with black inlays. So that the ebony fingerboard is matte, and maybe even the body of the guitar would be black and matte.
Mm-hmm. I'll look at the black. What I can do is, if I get your email, I can find what we think might do and just give you images, and you can send us images of the shapes that you want, bearing in mind we have to make it.
Oh, I'm excited. This would be brilliant. I mean, I've absolutely loved this, and you'll have to kick me out of here, but because I've got to go on tour, so I'm away for the next couple of months, but we will keep in touch via email and Skype, because I want to see how the progress as well. You know, this is my baby now.
Okay.
But I'll be back in 2 months' time, and hopefully you'll be able to pick the guitar up when I return to Glasgow.
Yeah, no problem.
Hi, Jimmy. Great to meet you and Stephen and have a guided tour around your workshop, as well as playing your beautiful guitars. As I said before, I'm not an acoustic player by any stretch of the imagination, but I know what I like. As we discussed, a narrow neck similar to the last guitar I tried, the C model. If the neck could be slightly slimmer than that, that would be brilliant. B, the same body
as the last guitar I tried. C, I still have an idea that I would like as black a finish as can be achieved, either similar to that of the ebony green guitar in progress you showed us in the guitar workshop, or even blacker, if possible, or at least more solid, consistent black. Many thanks for this. Midge, kid in a toy shop, you're. Basically, it's one of our standard guitars, but unusually we'll do all the bindings and inlays in a bright material. You know, these are all going to be very muted, so working them around a matte finish is going to be really difficult. It's tasking us, it really is. I don't see any problems. Problems sometimes seem bigger than they are, and once you get to it, you know, you can find the right compromise between the artist and the actuality of building something. We don't need to work like surgeons to make sure everything is absolutely bang on.
As I'm off touring America, let's have a quick update on the progress of my guitar back in Jimmy Moon's workshop.
Right, what I've got here is a Sitka spruce top. This comes from Alaska. I've already bent the sides into the shape, which is the C shape, which he's chosen, which is one of the standard models we do. We've got the blocks in that will hold, you know, the tail of it and the neck, and that's it. We've already started put the linings on, which again will extend the gluing area so that the top and the back can sit on them. These are patented clamps that we've made. You know, I would show you them, but I would probably break the copyright if I did. But they're actually closed pegs with elastic bands on them. The technical aspect of finishing it, once we get to that point, that's when we see a lot of time getting used up, maybe just in you know, things aren't going right, you know, so we just keep going at it until we get the result we want.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Jimmy?
Hi, hello there. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I'm still in America.
Oh my goodness.
I'm in New Orleans, so it sparked off my interest in what was going on with my guitar. Forget about me. How's the guitar doing?
The guitar's doing great. We've got the whole thing's really assembled. I've just to fret the fingerboard, get the fingerboard onto the neck, and it's into finishing.
Actually
looks quite good without any black paint on it. Nice sunburst would be lovely, you know.
Already it sounds like it's going to feel like an old friend.
Oh, so it should be good, you know, and I've got the neck down and the fingerboard down to the right size, I think. So if I can get the shape just right for you, we're on a winner.
Thank you very much. I'll catch up with you soon.
That's great. Take care now. Enjoy the rest of the tour. Bye now.
Thank you.
Now, I've listened and watched my favourite guitarists since I was a little boy growing up in Glasgow. Whether it was Peter Green, Eric Clapton or Mick Ronson, they all had their individual style and sound, no doubt driven by their choice of guitar. So which types of guitar suits which styles of which players? I caught up with one of Britain's finest jazz guitarists, Martin Taylor, to find out what he looks for in a guitar. Martin, I am in the process of having this beautiful guitar built to my specifications by Jimmy Moon. Now, you as a jazz guitar player must have totally different specifications. Can you tell me a bit about that?
Well, it's a little bit different for me because my guitars are arch-top guitars rather than the flat-top guitar that you're playing. My guitars are based on violin design. So what I'm looking for really is more of a woody, middly sound, you know. For what you're going to do with your guitar, you want something that's really going to sing out when you're playing. You know, when you're playing, it's like open chords, you want something that's going to really fill the room.
Absolutely.
And ring out. But for me, I want something that is, has got more of a middle sound to it. It's got that woodiness.
I can hear that. It's more, I mean, I get exactly what you're saying about the style. So I presume the kind of guitar you're talking about, the guitar you're using, it would have been the type of guitar they would have used in big bands in the 30s and 40s, where you would really have to kind of hit these things until amplification came along. But I presume you use pickups on the guitars you have.
I do. I mean, what I do most of the time is I blend them. So this is the acoustic sound of my guitar. Then I bring just a tiny bit of the pickup in. So it just kind of fattens the sound up just a little bit, gives it a warmth. But what I do mostly is I play solo, so I actually play finger style, so I'm not playing with a pick. And what this guitar does for me is it has a lot of definition and separation so that I can play. Getting into this finger style playing, I go between playing with the pick and playing finger style. So this is the most versatile guitar for me. If I played a flat top, like the guitar that Jimmy Moon has made you, it has a nice big bass sound. to it. But sometimes the top strings, the way the guitar is designed, it's not designed for those top strings to have a really kind of thick, fat sound to them. So it's, the top strings can sound just a little bit tinny when I'm playing fingerstyle on a guitar like that. So that's why I've kind of stuck with playing an archtop jazz guitar.
Well, I'd like to think that my beautiful new all-black guitar from Jimmy, maybe in 50 or 60 years' time, will have the same kind of history that some of the guitars I have now, that will be passed on. I mean, we're only there to look after them for a short while.
Yeah.
And then these instruments should be passed on, and they should carry the ghosts of the people who had them before. I'm going to end up with this very sparkly new instrument, but I'd like to think that, you know, who knows where it would be in 50, 100 years' time if it's still intact.
Yeah.
Mark Taylor, thank you very much for talking to me today.
Well, thanks, Midge.
So the week before I'm due back in Glasgow to pick up my new guitar, I've heard that Jimmy Moon has finished my matte black acoustic guitar, and all that's left now is to put the strings on and make a few final adjustments.
We're really pleased with the end result. The proof of the pudding will be once it hits the road, and we'll see how it does then. One of my things is there's no bad guitars, there's only bad engineers. It will change through, you know, the next couple of months as it realises it's no longer wood and it's now an instrument, and it'll start to react to the frequencies and different, different environments, and, you know, the temperatures, the humidity, you know, so there will be a relaxing period in the guitar. You know, it usually takes, you know, just a couple of months. It's finding that, you know, the realization to a player that it's a tool and it has a use and a life. And if they want to change the voice, then they change the tool. That's how the music industry works, you know, thankfully. Job done. On to the next one. Vienna!
It's been 8 weeks since I stood outside the entrance to Moon Guitars, when I put my order in for my bespoke guitar that Jimmy Moon's going to build for me. Now, he sent me some photographs and updates and little bits of video and stuff, and I've seen it from afar, but there's nothing quite like picking it up and giving it a right good strum. Hello.
Hello, dear.
Anyone home? How are you, young man?
Knackered.
Knackered, that's a good way to put it. I thought you'd say freezing. It's 8 weeks or so since I was last here.
I know.
And the weather's changed somewhat.
The job's done.
Is the job done?
Yeah.
Is it? How's it looking?
Looking good. Very black.
None more black.
No.
Right.
Okay, here we go.
Yeah. Let's have a look.
You nervous? I'm nervous.
Listen, I'm not. I know you've done a fantastic job. Oh, wow, look at that. That's a thing of beauty. That is wonderful. Just looking at this, the black inlays and the matte black.
Got your black saddle.
And a black saddle as well. Look at that. That's wonderful. Look. What was the... I know it was painful. I mean, it probably wasn't the build that was painful. More the finish.
The finish was difficult with trying to make sure we could see, you know, the bindings and the, you know, and the rosette and things like that, and the inlays, you know, just make sure they were visible, you know, so it was working out a way to do that.
How do you feel it's turned out?
It's like one of mine.
It's one of you. It's one of your babies.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. So do we get a chance to give it a strum?
You better.
I better had. How'd you get on with the neck, the width of it?
I was pretty happy with it, yeah.
You know what, if this was a car, it would be a bespoke sports car. It would be something that incredibly unique. I mean, even the look at that, the black machine heads as well, that just works absolutely beautifully. I love the fact that it's embossed. I can feel the name and your Moon crescent logo, the crescent moon up there.
That is just outstanding. What a job. Oh, it rings, doesn't it? It's beautiful. It's got a lovely depth to it and a lovely jangle. It's lovely, Jimmy.
Yeah, it
really
good.
Is. It really is beautiful. And the neck feels great. You know what? For a brand new guitar, it's there's a bit of deja vu going on here. It feels as though I've had this guitar before.
Oh.
And that's really, with the body size is perfect. Mm-hmm. It just sits really well balanced, sitting just perfectly there. I could sit and play this thing for hours. So Jimmy, does this feel like just another guitar off the production line for you? Or does it feel something special every time you make something like this?
Every time we do something, it is special. They're one-offs, they're a part of their mistakes and their designs that the people who's ordered them has put into it. So it's a unique piece. We have a sound and each one is different for different reasons. So I've had my fun with it, you know, so it's your chance now. You know, I'm quite happy with that. And when I see somebody playing them, it's always a joy.
If I was a better man, would fellow men take me to their hearts?
Fantastic.
You've been listening to In the Studio from the BBC World Service, following Jimmy Moon making a guitar for me, Midge. The producer was Nick Lowe for Demas Productions. To hear more from some of the world's most creative minds and see my new guitar, head to our website at bbcworldservice.com/in the studio.